Lynda Waggoner, Director of Fallingwater, 2 years. Lynda has promised to speak with the title God is in the Details, Managing the Museum Experience. And I hope you appreciate Lynda's presentation, because she actually missed one flight, or was it that the flight was cancelled, and she came here 7 a.m. this morning from the other side of the ocean. So please welcome Lynda.
Thank you, Susanna. I'm delighted to be here. I wasn't so sure I was going to be here, so it's great to be here. And I have to say that using a quote from Mies van der Rohe as the director of a Frank Lloyd Wright house is something that Wright would probably turn over in his grave over. Wright used to sit in his studio at Taliesin with fly swatter and swat flies and call them Mies Rovius and so forth. So, I'll be talking about the visitor's experience at Fallingwater. I've been at Fallingwater for a very long time, maybe 30 years now, and worked there as a guide in high school, then went on to study architecture and art history, coming back as the first curator. Fallingwater was put into the public domain in 1963, making it perhaps, the first modern house to come into the public domain. It's now been a museum longer than it was ever a private home. So we have learned a lot over the years in presenting it to the visitor. So some years ago, I read a book by Joe Pine called The Experience Economy. And in it, they talk about how today visitors value experience. And they use the example of a cup of coffee. A cup of coffee, just in terms of the beans, costs about 2 to 3 cents, something like that. A cup of coffee, packaged coffee, in all grounds up and ready to go, 9 to 15 cents a cup. Brewed coffee, $1.25 to $2.50 a cup. And then, of course, we have Starbucks, which is $2 to $5 a cup. Just showing you how, over time, we come to value not just the coffee itself, but the experience of coffee, which Starbucks has taken to new heights. Likewise, the evolution of the birthday cake. I think we can all remember when our mothers made birthday cake, at least I can remember when my mother made a birthday cake from raw ingredients. And then, as mothers began working, they bought a box cake because it was more convenient. And then they went to a bakery and bought a cake. Then they had a birthday party. I remember having one for my son at a hotel swimming pool with all of his friends. And today, people take 10 of their children's closest friends to Disney World for a birthday. So again, it's the economic value goes up with the depth of the experience, questionably whether it's really that much more. But what does this have to do with our visitors to museums? I think that in this day of canned experience, of commercialization of everything, we can provide an authentic, non-commercial experience for people that is transformative, and that's what we're trying to get to, the transformative experience. And frankly, when you do provide that kind of an experience for your visitors, it translates into support, because the one thing at least Americans do, and I'm sure most Westerners do, is when you have a great experience, a great day, you celebrate by eating out and going shopping. And so that's all something we're ready to help them with at our museum stores. So, if we dissect the museum experience, we know what we can control. We can control, in many cases, the physical setting, at least at Fallingwater we can, do a large site. We can control, to some degree, our staff attitudes, our procedures, how we manage our visitors, the interpretive content, and what we can control, often the weather we can't control, or the attitudes that visitors might arrive with. And what we did at Fallingwater, as I started thinking about the visitor experience, it occurred to me we needed to look at what were the major landscapes at Fallingwater, and what was the visitor's journey through those landscapes. So we identified these five landscapes, the approach landscape, that's the drive as you're coming to Fallingwater from either the north or the south, that's the only two directions one can arrive at. The estate landscape, once you get into the site itself. The visitor landscape, which is that of orientation, parking, dealing with all of those things one has to deal with when you arrive at a museum. The cultural landscape, and then the house landscape. And we decided, so here's the approach landscape. This is coming from the south, from close to either Maryland or West Virginia. We're in the mountains of Appalachia, the last ridge of the Appalachian chain. And this is the estate landscape with tall trees and a sense of the history, whereas the approach landscape is intended to be something of the overture to the house itself. We want people to feel as if they know they have arrived in sort of Fallingwater land. And then the estate landscape harkens back to the time when the house was the estate of the Kaufman family. And the visitor landscape is a visitor center where people gather and they're assigned their groups. The transition from the visitor landscape to the cultural landscape for us is a very important one. One goes down into the valley of Bear Run, the stream that flows under Fallingwater, and the whole goal here is one of decompression, of being able to leave everything behind you and to get into the spirit of the site. The cultural setting is the remnants of what is left of the evidence of family having lived there, cutting gardens, something of a rudimentary apple orchard, and the original driveway down to the house. And then the house landscape. And this is one of the issues at this particular juncture. I think people, again, it's not unlike the visitor landscape, the visitor's pavilion, because people come to the house and they're thinking, this isn't what I expected. Where's the waterfall? Where's the front door? What's happening there? What exactly is it? So it's visitors are often surprised, and what do I do now? And then, of course, the house itself, one enters from the southeast rather than the southwest where the waterfall is. This is one of contemplation. We started to really put together names or find words that describe some of these particular moments. This one, actually, I'm going to go back here. This is the aha moment. I see it for the first time. And then, of course, the orientation one. And this is the contemplation of the house. Discovery, where is the front door? It's slipped right there between the walls. Connection with the house itself and perhaps how the people live there, because it is an intact site. Prospect, the view from the terraces of the house down into the gorge. And then after the house tour itself, and people walk back down from the guest house, which is up on the hillside, down the driveway, it's one of appreciation. And then the wow moment. And then finally commemoration. We felt that there was really very little we could do to improve upon what was already a very well choreographed experience of Fallingwater that Wright had designed. We felt we could deal with the arrival at the bridge, but there wasn't a whole lot else we could do there. But we could deal with some of the other issues on the site. For example, the approach. Fallingwater is owned by a land conservation group. We have 5,000 acres that surround the house, and you can see it. I'm sure there's a point here where but I'm not sure. That's it. Okay, yeah. So this is the road that comes up to Fallingwater, and Fallingwater is down in here. This is the view from the street. We own this barn, which we restored, actually made it into a facility for offices and also events. And then we had several other houses on the site, which we owned as we were acquiring property, because our goal was to acquire the entire watershed that flows beneath Fallingwater. These we restored to for summer interns. This was a little schoolhouse that had been a caretaker's house, which we restored again to a schoolhouse, a one-room schoolhouse, based on photographs, and that's where we have educational programs. So we tried to get a sense of what the place was like when the Coffins lived there. And then at the estate landscape, the entrance to the site, we removed a gate that had been put in after the Kaufmans had given the house to the Conservancy by a well-meaning individual who had created a Frank Lloyd Wright-ish gate. You know, in the United States, Frank Lloyd Wright is practically an industry in itself. And one of the challenges many of the Frank Lloyd Wright sites have, I think, is creating Frank Lloyd Wright-ish things at their sites. So we took this gate out because we didn't want any confusion about what was real and what was not at the site. And we also wanted to deal with signage on the site. This was the sign that was there. You can see it here. And we thought our goal was to create a seamless experience of Fallingwater and to evoke the spirit of the house, which is one of quiet elegance and a harmony in nature. So this sign was replaced with the one you see in stone. We had another issue because we're a very popular site. We now have about 160,000 people coming to the house. That's 14 people going through the front door every 6 minutes during high season. And we're closed January through March, or through mid-March. So cars were backing up, out into the highway. We just put a new gatehouse in. We separated the space so that people weren't frustrated. Every tour of Fallingwater is by reservation. And people are given very specific times, and there was a lot of anxiety because we're not really in anybody's backyard. So people typically drive at least 4 hours to come see the house, and we were getting very anxious about getting in. This addressed that problem. The parking lot was a miserable parking lot. We had problems with students crossing in front of traffic. There were no sidewalks, things of that sort there. So we redid the parking lots to provide, again, a more intimate experience of nature and to break up the hardtop and provide permeable paving, do things that would be consistent with a land conservation organization, which we are part of. We changed all of the signage on site again, too. We had very simple. One thing that happens, I think, at a site, when your staff tell you people are getting lost, they think more signs will be better. In fact, signs are really pretty useless. It's better to have a logical progression through the site. And we found that by creating pathways that made sense, that we could get rid of multiple signs that told you the parking lot's this way, the pavilion's that way, and then there's a self-guided nature walk somewhere else. It's unclear where. And we did some interesting signs like this one, which is just a kind of a beacon that leads you to the visitor's pavilion. So all of this in a way to get the visitor in the mood for what they're going to see next, which is, of course, parking lot. Signage at the pavilion itself. At one point, there were signs hung off the ceiling between each one of these piers in the pavilion. And in an open-air pavilion, to have a sign that says exit is really kind of silly. So that was an easy decision to make. We simply put the name of whatever the space was in the transom above the doors. Accessibility is an increasing issue, I think, for all of us. We have lots of visitors who are not really very able to travel a site, and our site's a very difficult one. Lots of steps, 100 steps in the house itself, and the house is a quarter of a mile from the visitor's pavilion, and one has to walk gently. So wheelchair-bound individuals were having to come in the service entrance, and we recently redid all of that so that it could be easier for visitors to come. Kindles for those who can't go through the house itself so they can see the tour. A shuttle rather than a van, which was very difficult for some people to get in and out of, and now we're doing a hearing assist devices on site. And this is an accessibility path to a view so that that visitors can have a view of Fallingwater itself. Fallingwater, the classic view, the wow view I mentioned earlier, is down a rather steep walk, not possible to get to if you're wheelchair bound. But we have another wonderful bird's eye view that they can see instead. So procedures were another thing we felt we could deal with. At one time, we would simply gather people at the visitor's pavilion in groups of 14, which is the size of the tour group, and send them down to the house. They'd go down the boardwalk, turn left at the bottom of the boardwalk, walk several hundred feet down to the house, turn right at the bridge, and find the front door. And people were everywhere. We were losing them like crazy. So a simple solution to that was simply to organize the group at the pavilion, get their attention. You could see then they had oversized bags that needed to be taken from them before they went into the house. If they had any difficulties in walking, you could anticipate that. And then get them down to the house where the guide came out of the house, met them at the bridge in a very gracious way, and then takes them through the house. Cleanliness, of course, this is like a no-brainer really, but we decided we were going to get rid of all the trash receptacles on our site. One of the problems with a site like ours, where one travels so far to get there, is that there are cars filled up with McDonald's bags and various other things in their travels, and they dump it when they get to our place. And we were having a lot of trash removal as a result of that. So we decided what we would do would just get rid of them and tell them if they brought it in, they have to take it out. That also meant that at the cafe, we had to move from paper plates and plastic silverware to stainless and china, but that's all good. That's what we're about. Weather. One of the things we can't control, but indeed we can do a little bit with it, by providing people with umbrellas so that they're not lost out in the woods when the downpour comes and gets soaking wet. And the guys are also really very good when it's raining outside. I hear them say to people, "You are so lucky to be here on a rainy day. The house is just, it so reflects what's going on in nature. It's just an extraordinary experience in the rain." And people go for that, so tell them that, they'll believe it. In fact, it's true, it is wonderful. So staff are very important in everything we do at the site. You know, researchers say that people respond to people who smile genuinely. And a genuine smile means there have to be wrinkles on either side of the mouth. Not a polite smile, a genuine smile. And again, all of this translates, into what we need to support our sites, and that is income. Fallingwater is not, even though it's been around for a long time, it has a wonderful attendance, we do not have a big endowment. We are not government supported. We have to earn all of our money. So we have to earn it through admissions or sales. And wonderful experiences at the site also translate into high sales. So that's very important to us. And so that's pretty much what we do in terms of visitor experience at Fallingwater. There's a lot more I could, of course, tell you about the house, but that's how we deal with the visitor at the site. Thank you.